Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome everyone to the main quadrangle on the University of South Carolina Upstate's campus to participate in one of our institution's most venerated traditions. Would everyone please be seated? The investiture of the Chancellor marks an important era for this campus and for the entire Carolina family. On this joyous day, we come together to reflect on the successes of our past and to anticipate the progress of our future. Attending today are faculty, students, alumni, trustees, government officials, citizens of the region, and friends. And together we will witness the placing of our symbolic mantles of authority on Dr. Thomas Moore, the Chancellor of the University of South Carolina Upstate. Please join me early on in this program in officially welcome Tom Moore, his wife Marcia, and his sons Charlie and Kirk to the Carolina family. Tom Moore is a dynamic leader with a serious passion for knowledge and for liberal arts. He also understands the relationship our school has with the regional community, and I know that Dr. Moore has the tools to advance economic development in the Upstate. As a scholar, Dr. Moore has excellent credentials. As an administrator and a leader, he brings skills which will undoubtedly benefit the progress of this university. Over 45 years old, the Upstate campus is a cherished part of the Carolina family. Our achievements and successes have made this one of the fastest growing universities in the Southeast. This campus has became a four-year institution in 1975. And it is truly a comprehensive metropolitan university with full accreditation to provide baccalaureate and master's degrees. 5,500 students come from across the Upstate region, and they come from 36 states and 51 countries. They populate this beautiful 330-acre campus and make it a vital living learning community. The march to reach that size with its quality and impact has been stunning. Let's take a moment to applaud the incredibly skillful work of our faculty and our administrators and staff, without whose tireless dedication we would not be here today. Please help me recognize the faculty and staff of the university. And let's also take a moment to recognize our Board of Trustees. Serving as volunteers, they make a sacrifice of their time and resources to benefit the quality of life in the Upstate and throughout the state, and to increase the quality of education throughout South Carolina. Please help me congratulate the Board of Trustees. And now to move on with our program, would you please rise for the presenting of the colors and the national anthem, which will be sung by the USC Upstate University Singers, led by Ms. Kathy Gianni. This will be followed by the invocation offered by the Reverend Lawrence Hayes of Mount Hebron United Methodist Church.
Please be seated. Let us pray. God of truth and knowledge, by your wisdom, we are taught the way and the truth. By your Spirit, we are inspired to give our best for others. By your grace, we are freed to live life victoriously. We come this day to ask your blessing on your servant, Thomas Frederick Moore, and on this institution through which he will serve you. Under his leadership, make this place to be a lively center for sound learning, new discovery, and the pursuit of wisdom. Grant that all those who teach here and learn here may find you to be the source of all truth. We thank you for all the events in Dr. Moore's life that have led him to this time and place. We praise you for those who have been his teachers, mentors, companions, and friends through the years. We thank you for your church, which has nourished his spirit and deepened his soul. We thank you for his family, for Marcia and Charlie and Kirk, and the way in which they have made his life so rich that he is enabled to share it with others. God of all good gifts, grant to Dr. Moore a keen insight into the needs of each student and a nurturing spirit to each faculty and staff. Give him the courage to make difficult decisions with confidence and trust in your providence. And give to him and to this great university that greatest of all gifts, the assurance of your faithful presence. Holy and majestic God, we offer this for your name's sake. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Hayes. I'm delighted that we will now receive greetings to the university and to the chancellor from representatives of the community as designated in your program.
I'm Junie White, mayor of the city of Spartanburg. Dr. Moore, on behalf of the citizens of the city of Spartanburg and Spartanburg County, I'm very proud to be taking part in this great occasion. Dr. Moore, you're becoming the third chancellor of this great university. It has grown in 45 years under the leadership of chancellors Dr. Olin Sandbury and Dr. John Stockwell to a high academic standard university. Your outstanding academic background, your leadership qualities, your openness, warmth, caring, and understanding of young people will make you a great leader for USC Upstate. Under your leadership, this university is going to educate the young men and women in challenges of life and instill in them the desire to become future leaders using the academic and social skills they will achieve while here at USC Upstate. The citizens of Spartanburg offer you hope and prayer as a new chancellor. We will stand ready to assist you in any way. Chancellor Moore, congratulations and welcome to Spartanburg.
I'm the other Mayor White from Greenville. It is a great honor to participate today in the investiture of Dr. Thomas Moore as Chancellor of the University of South Carolina Upstate. The city of Greenville recognizes the critical role that higher education plays in the development of the upstate region of South Carolina. In the eyes of the world, Greenville and Spartanburg share a common identity and are indeed part of a common economy. World-class businesses such as BMW and Michelin and GE and Milliken call our region home, and people from all over the world are taking note. USC Upstate, as a true Metropolitan University knits together our two communities ever more tightly in a mutual bond of commitment to higher education. As in so many things in life, location, location, location is of critical importance. In USC Upstate, spread across a beautiful main campus adjacent to one of the world's great economic engines, Interstate 85, is poised for future greatness. But location alone is not its only strength. Through many decades now, a tradition of vision and leadership has been the true reason for this university's success. So today, this tradition is affirmed. Congratulations, Dr. Moore. We're so proud to share in this great day, and we look forward to a closer collaboration with USC Upstate. Thank you.
Good morning, I'm Kathy Canino, the faculty chair. Dr. Moore, it is my great privilege and pleasure to bring greetings to you from all of the faculty of the University of South Carolina Upstate, as well as those from the many other colleges and universities represented here today. We stand with you as you advocate for free inquiry and as you articulate clearly the vital role the modern university can and should play in advancing the best interest of our citizenry across a diverse range of constituencies and stakeholders. We stand behind you as you provide leadership in marshaling the resources vital to the advancement of higher education and for realizing the promise of this great university. We stand beside you as you remain strong in confronting the many challenges of the coming years. We share in your enthusiasm for USC Upstate and in your vision of a future that is bright with promise. Finally, we thank you and we salute you for the extraordinary effort you will exert as a voice of higher education for South Carolina. Chancellor Moore, welcome.
Dr. Moore, I extend greetings to you on behalf of the faculty and administrations of all campuses of the University of South Carolina, Aiken, Beaufort, Columbia, Lancaster, Saukahatchee, Sumter, and Union. We are the teacher scholars who educate those students that are pursuing USC degrees on non-Columbia campuses and who represent 38% of the university's undergraduate enrollment. We support the metropolitan mission of USC Upstate as a comprehensive senior campus within a statewide community of campuses, each specialized to serve the needs of its student bodies and its local community, and each a valued partner in an interdependent, multi-campus university structured to serve the citizens of South Carolina from the Lowcountry to the Piedmont. As the new chancellor of the University of South Carolina's second largest institution, we ask that you renew USC Upstate's commitment to collaboration, interconnectedness, and collegiality among students, faculty, administrators, and campuses. Please remember that the success of each university campus represents the success of all. Dr. Moore, we believe you to be an inspired choice to lead USC Upstate because of your deep commitment to undergraduate education, student success, and your appreciation of the important role of faculty as teacher scholars in a liberal arts education. May we, as system colleagues, be a supportive wind beneath your Spartan wings. Congratulations to you, Marcia, and your family.
Good morning, I'm Anna Asuna. Dr. Moore, on behalf of the students at the University of South Carolina Upstate, I greet and welcome you to the Upstate family. In many ways, this institution exists through the life and experiences of its students and to fulfill our mission of becoming a leading metropolitan university. South Carolina's future, especially in the Upstate, rests upon this university's ability to provide an affordable, accessible, meaningful, and excellent education so that the students of today can meet intellectual, social, and career professional objectives by becoming productive, knowledgeable citizens of our communities and the world, both now and in the future. Therefore, we challenge you, as the leader of this university, enhance opportunities for all students, develop a vision for an unparalleled undergraduate program, and prevail in pursuing the positioning of this university to be recognized as an academic leader in the Upstate and as a critical partner in its economic and social development. We ask you to demand both rigor and integrity from the faculty, staff, and administrators who have such an impact upon us, and we ask that you demand the same of ourselves. We know you will lead this university with energy, vision, and integrity. Please continue to listen to our voices as we continue to support you and your efforts. Remain open to us, the students, and we will support you. Thank you.
I'm Chris Crowley, member of the class of 2011. Dr. Moore, on behalf of the more than 21,500 alumni of this great university, I greet you and bring you our best wishes. I speak for those who have departed this life and whose lives were blessed by the knowledge and experience gained at USC Upstate. As students, we were the beneficiaries of this great university's loving hopes and aspirations. As alumni, we hold this institution near to our heart because it embodies the promise of our potential and because it is a bedrock of learning upon which our dreams are built. We represent the result of her mission, and we strive to herald her accomplishment throughout the world. USC Upstate will forever constitute part of whom we are and who we hope to become. We pledge to remain pillars of our University of South Carolina Upstate by facilitating for her the highest expectations for academic excellence now and in the future. We beseech you to call on us, the alumni, as you lead this noble institution into the promise of tomorrow.
Thank you, Mr. Crowley, of the class of 2011, and all of our USC Upstate community delegates. At this time, I'm pleased to introduce Dr. Jerry Odom, who will present Dr. Moore for the charge and then the presentation of the medallion. Dr. Odom has served the University of South Carolina Columbia in many capacities and with distinction. As professor and chair of the Chemistry and Biochemistry Department, Dean of the College of Science and Mathematics, and Executive Vice President for Academic Affairs and Provost. Dr. Odom recruited me and Patricia to the University of South Carolina, and as you will soon hear, played a pivotal role in Dr. Moore's career as well. Please welcome Dr. Odom.
President Pastides, Board of Trustees, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, and Dr. Tom Moore. What a beautiful day for a ceremony, and I am happy to be a part of it. Very honored to be asked to deliver the presentation, and I want to make some personal remarks about Chancellor Moore this morning. I feel confident that I have known Tom and Marcia longer than most people here today. Tom enrolled in the graduate program in chemistry at the University of South Carolina, Columbia, in the fall of 1973, and early in 1974, chose me as his research advisor as he worked for his PhD in inorganic chemistry. In academic circles, Tom then became my chemical son. As in any family, every child is different and must be treated accordingly, and I will have more to say about that in just a minute. Tom and I have maintained a close relationship over the years, and I have done what I can, and I didn't really need to do more, to help him obtain the positions that he has held in his academic journey. Let me say at the outset that I am as proud of Tom and what he has accomplished, especially with this position that we are celebrating today, as any father. In the experimental scientific world, a research advisor and his or her graduate students normally become extremely close because they work side by side in the laboratory. This was certainly the case with Tom and me. I was a young assistant professor when Tom joined my research group, and I wanted to be promoted and I wanted to be tenured, and I expected the students in my group to work as hard as I did. I didn't expect more, but I sure expected them to do what I was willing to do. And that meant 6 days a week, Monday through Saturday, and at least 5 nights a week, Monday through Thursday and Sunday. This is where Tom and I begin to differ. You know, from the moment I met Tom, it was evident that he was a fun-loving, social individual who knew how to have a good time. I have to tell you, that's not changed one bit right up until today. Tom clearly had enjoyed a robust social life as an undergraduate, and it appeared to me that he wanted to continue that style of living during graduate school, and I begged to differ with him. We would from time to time have what I would consider candid conversations about Tom's work ethic in our one-on-one research meetings. Tom clearly had the intellectual ability to master the material in his coursework, and his grades were never an issue. He was also a fantastic teacher. In fact, I remember clearly that Tom won a departmental teaching award based on student evaluations in what we called a problem session. These were students who had passed the laboratory portion of the general chemistry course but had failed the lecture portion. They were repeaters, they didn't want to be there, and they were not an easy group to teach. But Tom did an excellent job of teaching them, primarily, I think, because of his upbeat personality. What I needed to try to get across to Tom, and I tried to work with him to explain that real success in earning a PhD in chemistry would be to develop independence in research and to demonstrate critical thinking skills in his research projects. In the first couple of years, every time we took a couple of steps forward, we seemed to take one backwards. Things actually came to a head with Tom and me in 1976 when I was spending a sabbatical year in Germany at the University of Stuttgart. I expected my students to send me a tape on a weekly basis describing in detail what they had accomplished that week. You might ask, why a tape? You have to remember that's before Al Gore invented the internet. It was clear from these tapes that Tom was not making much progress because he wasn't doing very much in the laboratory. I really agonized about what I should do, and I finally sent him a letter basically telling Tom that it was time to make up his mind, either get to work or give up his idea of a PhD. I still have his reply today, and it was a very thoughtful reply. It was introspective, and I think Tom and I basically agreed at that point, and he turned his situation around. He slowly but surely developed into the excellent student and researcher that I knew he could be. Tom received his PhD in 1978 with a dissertation entitled Nuclear Magnetic Resonance Studies of Substituted Boron Hydrides and Organoboranes. Now I can see everybody's right on the edge of their seat. They want me to tell them more about what was in that thesis, but I'm going to pass that. I do want you to know that Tom had enough research accomplished to publish 7 excellent articles in peer-reviewed journals, and those articles went in his dissertation. This, in my opinion, was a tremendous success story and was really just the beginning of Tom's rapid and meaningful rise in the academic world. Just as I would have predicted, Tom continued his excellent teaching and then focused his talents on administration when he moved from Birmingham Southern College to become chair of the Chemistry and Physics Department at Winthrop University. He then became Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences, and I can't tell you how proud I was when he finally became Vice President for Academic Affairs and Dean of the Faculty at Winthrop, because at that time I was Provost at the University of South Carolina, Columbia, and we basically had reached identical positions in our lives. I must tell you, it's a real honor to be a chief academic officer at an institution of higher learning. Academics should be and are the name of the game, and if there is ever a job that requires critical thinking, problem-solving skills, and social skills in dealing with the faculty, Provost is it. As I said earlier, no one is prouder of Tom than I am, except for Marcia, who has been a very steadying influence, in my opinion, in their relationship ever since I have known them. In fact, I think Marcia and I were a great tag team at one time in pushing Tom towards his PhD. There was a time I would not have predicted that we would be installing him as Chancellor of USC Upstate today. However, as I have watched him grow and develop, I think this is a perfect match, and I look for great things both from Tom and from this campus. Congratulations, son.
Well, thank you, Dr. Odom. It's certainly clear that there are no two people on this planet that could have made that presentation. And I'm glad you were my provost, but I'm also glad I didn't work under you for my PhD. Tom, I like to have a good time, too. At this time, the moment we've all been waiting for, I asked Dr. Thomas Moore to come forward. He will be joined by USC Board of Trustees Chairman Miles Lodeholt and USC Upstate Faculty Senate Chair Catherine Canino, who will assist me with the medallion. Dr. Thomas Moore, the University of South Carolina's Board of Trustees, and I are charged by the General Assembly, on behalf of all the people of South Carolina, to oversee a most vital enterprise dealing with the quality of life in South Carolina. Our university has pledged itself to be a faithful index to the ambitions and fortunes of the state. The task before you as our new chancellor is large. You must court many constituencies for support. You must inspire the many people involved in every aspect of the university's life and work every day of each year by being the leader of our students, faculty, and staff. You must remind us to infuse every aspect of collegiate life with the integrity inherent in discovering and imparting knowledge and truth, with the tenets of the Carolinian Creed as a guide. It now will be my privilege to bestow on you the emblems of office that symbolize the responsibilities which you have already borne admirably for some months. Will all please rise? Dr. Thomas Moore, by virtue of the authority vested in the Board of Trustees by the General Assembly, acting on behalf of the people of this state, I hereby do install you as the Chancellor of the University of South Carolina Upstate. I charge you to guide and guard this historic citadel of learning. If you willingly accept the challenge, accept with it this medallion and chain of office that designates you as the embodiment of the institution's power and authority. Let's congratulate Dr. Moore.
So proud of you. Thank you, guys. Thank you so very much.
Be seated.
Thank you. Thank you, President Pastides, Chairman Lodeholt, Dr. Canino, Mayors White, Reverend Hayes. I want to skip Dr. Odom, but I won't. Dr. Odom, Secretary Stone, members of the USC Board of Trustees, I want to thank Mr. Tommy Young, Chairman of the Spartanburg County Commission for Higher Education, and members of that commission. Presidents and representatives, designees of sister universities who are here to celebrate with us today, deans, faculty, staff, students, alumni, friends, family, thank you all for being here today. I'm reminded of words I first heard by Ralph Kettner, who is co-founder of Food Lion, when he was giving a talk after receiving an award at Catawba College in Salisbury, North Carolina. He began by saying that being here under these circumstances, under these conditions, reminds him of a turtle who woke up and found himself on top of a fence post. And after realizing where he was, his first thought was, well, the clearest thing about this situation is I didn't get here by myself. It's no truer of that turtle on the fence post than it is of me today, and I'm indebted to many people, some on this stage, some out here, some other places. Who got me here? And probably Jerry Odom as much as anybody. I want to say a special word of thanks to the people who led the founding and growth of this institution. Dr. G.B. Hodge, whom I never met, but who was a driving force, the original Spartanburg County Commission for Higher Education, and the surviving member of that group is with us today, Mr. Cleveland Harley. Bubba has been a part of this institution since its founding, a major supporter. Please help me thank Bubba Harley for his great work on behalf of this institution. I want to thank my predecessors as chancellor, John Stockwell and Olin Sansbury. I see John with us. I haven't seen Olin, but he might be here. He is here. Would Olin and John please accept our appreciation for your great work and leadership? I couldn't get through today without publicly acknowledging the great work of Tammy Whaley. If anything goes well today, it's because somebody listened to what Tammy told them to do, and they did it the way she said to do it. If anything is messed up, somebody didn't do what Tammy told them to do or didn't read all of that email or something. Please join me in expressing appreciation to Tammy Whaley, who has gone above and beyond. Many of you have made financial contributions to support this event, and I'm grateful. I'm not going to list names or get into that, but know that this institution appreciates it. Lunch will be better because of your support. The facilities are better because of your support. Thank you very much for that support. You've heard some from Harris and others about the importance of this institution in its brief 45-year history to this region, the quality of life and economic vitality of the upstate of South Carolina. I want to ask you to think with me for just a minute about what the upstate of South Carolina might be like. Try to imagine what this part of the world would be like if the University of South Carolina upstate did not exist and had never existed. Think about the graduates who are here. One of the really surprising things initially, no more because it happens every time, when I moved here and would go to functions, and I went to a lot and met a lot of people, I don't think I went to a single one where more than five people were gathered, where someone didn't approach me and say, I'm a 1980 what graduate of the university, I'm a 1990 something graduate of the university. And those people were at those events because they were leaders in some capacity in this part of the world. They were doing great work and great things and involved in philanthropic various organizations of service and economic vitality and enlivening the life in this part of the world. Think of the faculty and staff that this institution has brought to Spartanburg and the upstate. Their roles as teachers and learners, not just the students they produce, but what they do in volunteer work and service and providing, in using their expertise in the community. We have various targets in our metropolitan mission, various institutes and agencies, our Child Advocacy Center, our Visual Impairment Program, the Metropolitan Studies Institute, the Watershed Ecology Center. It wouldn't come to me, I'm sorry. All of these things live out the metropolitan mission of this university and enhance the quality of life here and beyond and provide numerous opportunities for our students to, as they're a student here, engage in applying what we know and how we learn
to enhancing the quality of life in this part of the world and beyond. What would this part of the world be without USC Upstate? And I know, and many of you know, that the future of this region, its economic vitality and the quality of life, depend on the success of USC Upstate in living that metropolitan mission effectively and efficiently. It won't surprise people who know me well, particularly some friends from Winthrop who dealt with me for the last 25 years. I have some questions about higher education today that I think we need to raise and hold before us as we move this institution and the entire higher ed enterprise into the future. I come at this from a couple of angles. One is my focus on ends and means. I have described myself in the past as a pragmatic idealist. I start with what is the ideal and look at where we are as best we can understand it and see how are we moving from where we are now toward that ideal that we have identified. Institutions are all formed with very high ends. Educational institutions to equip people and through our public service and research to enhance the quality of life where we are and around the world. Over time, in any human endeavor, those ends develop means to achieve those ends. And over time, the means to the high ends become treated often as ends in themselves. That might happen 3, 4, 6, 150 times in the long lifetime of an institution, to a point where we might lose focus on what these high ends are and get lost in treating what are really means to perhaps even lower ends as ends in themselves. I think the world has changed a lot more than higher education has changed, and we need to think about some things somewhat differently. The other source of my thoughts today is a book I referred to in my remarks at the December convocation. I apologize to those of you who were there and heard it. I'll be a lot briefer on it here. Rebecca Costa's book, The Watchman's Rattle. A major theme of that book, Costa having studied three cultures that advanced, very advanced cultures for their times, the Mayans in South America, the Romans in Europe, and the Khmer in what is now Cambodia in Asia. And she saw that these advanced cultures, in these advanced cultures, there came a time when the kinds of thinking and solutions to problems, the way problems were approaches, the thought patterns, the approaches to knowing, became unable to solve the complex problems that emerged from that in that advanced culture. I'm going to say that again. The methods, mindsets, thought patterns, approaches to understanding and learning that had produced the advanced culture became unable to solve the most critical issues and problems that arose in those advanced cultures. She defined such a situation as a cognitive threshold, and the first sign of a cognitive threshold in Costa's mind is gridlock. I'm not going to say any more about that, but I hope I've stimulated your thinking a little bit and maybe motivated you to buy the book and read it. It's a very insightful book. So what does that say about higher education? Ends and means. And might we be approaching a time in this country, in this culture, where the advances, that thinking that has led us, those kinds of education, the way we have approached education writ large, has led to this advancement in our culture, but is it now able to solve the most critical issues that emerge in our advanced culture? I'm not sure it is. We'll think about it. Here's some questions that come to my mind out of those approaches. Universities are institutions designed and founded for permanence and stability. And we live in a world where change is a dominant, if not the dominant, characteristic. Is that sustainable for colleges and universities? To be in a world where change is the norm, everything is changing, and the institutional structures, curriculum processes, departmental structures, administrative structures, how we get new programs approved through a department, through a college, through the university, through a commission on higher education, through a board of trustees. These structures that are there to ensure accountability and permanence and stability. Can they respond effectively and efficiently in a world where change is a dominant characteristic? And it probably takes about 2 years to bring a new academic program online from the decision at the department level to offer it, through all the levels of approval and authorization to start teaching classes in that program. Is that going to work into the future? I'm not sure it is.
If we started today in the world we live in, knowing what we know about this world, and that we don't know what the future holds, but we know some of the things that are going to be part of it, and that is change, how would we design institutions of higher education, curricula, down to specific courses, if we had no connection, made no connection to how we ourselves were educated? It just flies all over me when I think I've just been got my bling as the chancellor of a 5,500 student comprehensive metropolitan university, and my formal education was 100% from printed pages and face-to-face communication. Every piece of information I got was from a printed page or from a face-to-face communication with an individual. I could pull out an iPhone right now and access every database in our library if I could remember my password. People don't have to come to us anymore. The information is available. Universities existed because the information was in the libraries and the faculties and in the textbooks and the things people had to come to us to have access to. That is no longer true. If we design programs for the contemporary world with no connection to how we did it, what would they look like? It's an interesting question. We're a long way from being there. We got too many levels of curriculum approval to make those changes in any timely manner. But it's a question higher education must entertain and participate in. I'm somewhat increasingly concerned that the way we prepare PhDs in research universities is increasingly misaligned with the jobs we need entry-level tenure-track faculty to do at a comprehensive metropolitan university such as USC Upstate. The levels of specialization in PhD programs now are at such a high level where individual competence, specialized expertise is the coin of the realm, the highest value. And someone leaves that environment and comes into a USC Upstate where they're not in a department of microbiology. They're the microbiologist in a department of biology. They don't have to defend what they know against their similarly credentialed and expertised colleagues. They have to share what they know with those colleagues because they're the only microbiologist here. They have to learn from those colleagues because some of those colleagues have been teaching undergraduate freshman students at the University of South Carolina Upstate for a number of years, and that person coming in has never done that. I don't know what we do, and I don't know what the answers are, but I think it's a reality we need to acknowledge. And the way we indoctrinate, maybe the wrong word, the way we culture people when they come here, that word's there somewhere, but it's not going to come out of me. The way we bring them in and acclimate them to our environment and the work we do and what our priorities are, we need to be aware of what they're coming from and the misalignment between that and what they're here to do. Woodrow Wilson said the divisions of the world are not the divisions of the university. That specialized disciplinary structure, our students don't live their lives in disciplines. They live their lives. We carve the world up into disciplines and present it and describe it and understand it that way. How we connect that to the way they live their lives and engage is an issue that relates to the way we train PhD faculty and the way we introduce those people to our environment. Golly Moses, I stand here as a new chancellor, and I know we're educating students who have learned what they know in remarkably different ways than I learned anything I know. And we're educating those students for a world that none of us knows. How challenging and yet how exciting is that? It's incredible. And even given all of that, I'm thrilled to be here. And as long as we make the main thing, and focus on the right values and ideals, we can make it work and we can equip citizens of this part of the world and beyond to live meaningfully and work productively and enhance the quality of life here and around the world, wherever they are. And that is the high end that USC Upstate exists to approach. We must do that. My pledge to you as Chancellor, as we live out this mission, is that USC Upstate will be accessible and affordable to the citizens of South Carolina and beyond. And they will get the highest quality educational experience that they can find in South Carolina. We will be accountable to all constituencies for our levels of efficiency and effectiveness. And those two things go hand in hand and produce the way we are accountable to those to whom we serve and those to whom we report. In doing those things, we will fear no questions about our world or ourselves. If somebody needs to know, we tell them what we can. We hold the mirror up, and we don't just look at what's wrong over there. We look at how well we're doing in modeling the knowledge, the approaches, the capacities, the behaviors that we hope to instill in students. I'm absolutely convinced that it's a reality and enduring property of the human condition that we can't educate anyone any higher in anything. Integrity, honesty, work ethic. Thank you, Jerry. Then we model and demonstrate those things in our personal and professional lives on a daily basis with each other and with our students. They can't get beyond where we are able to take them, and we can't take them anywhere we aren't. The biggest difference between me and that turtle is he was on that fence post by himself, and I'm clearly not. I'd laugh too if I could. I'm surrounded by people who are passionate about and committed to the mission and success of this university. We have great challenges before us. Let us embrace those challenges together and live this university into its bright and hopefully remarkable future. I thank you for being here today. Please join us for lunch. Go Spartans. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you. Thank you very much. If you all think we got the right guy, the right pragmatic idealist, let's show Dr. Tom Moore what we really think of him today. Well done. Beautiful. Please remain standing, if you will. At this time, Rabbi Yossi Leibowitz of Temple B'nai Israel will deliver our benediction.
The last speaker. What a powerful position I have. Some 3,000 years ago, at a mountain called Sinai, we were taught to behold the unity of all creation. In all holy places, with all sacred traditions, we were instructed to love our Creator with all our hearts, with all our souls, with all our being. That invitation to find the Spirit was accompanied by this sacred imperative, V'shinantam levanecha, you will teach your children. And so as we prepare to conclude our celebrations this day, we do so with a renewed confidence of heart and mind. We go forth with an invigorated sense of joy and purpose. We ask Almighty God to bless our new chancellor, a special leader whose warmth, whose brightness inspires all. We ask God to bless all who support the endeavors of our fine institution of learning. As we leave to do our work this day, we hope to be ever worthy of its most sacred obligation. You will teach your children. May God bestow upon all who are gathered here today strength. May God bless all who are gathered here and everywhere with the blessings of peace. And let us all say, Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Rabbi. Now please join in our USC Upstate Gospel Choir, led by Mr. Hoyt Bynum, in the singing of our alma mater. After the alma mater, we will have the recessional of the platform party. and I hope all of you, as Tom invited you, will join he and Marcia and all of us for lunch, which will be held on the main quadrangle. Godspeed to all.
Thank you.